To College Park, Maryland, where tonight the Terrapins host Syracuse in what will be the only regular season meeting as members of the ACC. Head-to-head between these two, Syracuse started 25-0. They've lost consecutive games, including Saturday's controversial finish at Duke.
Offensive roll! Duke is living!
I just thought that was the worst call of the year, that's all. And I just hated to see the game decide on that call.
They'll look to bounce back tonight against a Maryland team looking for a resume-building win. And then at 9, number 5, Kansas can clinch a share of the Big 12 title for the 10th consecutive year if they defeat the Oklahoma Sooners. You're watching the ACC on ESPN. After three straight weeks as the number one team of the country, Syracuse now ranked number 4, taking on Maryland at College Park at a sold-out Comcast Center. The building will be full for the first time this year, and it is already alive. Syracuse no longer atop the ACC standings. One loss behind Virginia. 4 games left for the Cuse, including tonight. They'll be at Virginia, the big one, 4 o'clock Saturday afternoon on ESPN. Maryland in the middle of the pack, really needs a win with an eye toward making the NCAA tournament. Hi, everybody. Welcome. Sean McDonough along with Jay Billis, joined in a moment by Janine Edwards. Delighted to have you with us. Jay, that ending Saturday night, you were there. That's been the talk of college basketball for the last 48 hours. But now Syracuse needs to put it in the past. What do they do to focus on what's ahead?
Well, as you say, they've got to move on to the next game. Whether they had won or lost, this game starts at 7, and it counts as an ACC game. You mentioned on Saturday they play Virginia again, the number one team in the conference right now. They have a chance for an ACC regular season championship and a number one seed in the NCAA tournament. Who's got more to play for than Syracuse? They've not shot the ball well of late. Over the last 5 games, they've struggled from the field. Their scoring is down 13, 14 points a game. They're under 40% from the field. In the last 3 games, they are shooting 30% from outside the paint. They've got to get Trevor Cooney more involved. And I think Tyler Ennis has got to become more of a scorer than just a distributor. And also, Maryland's a tough matchup for them because Maryland's got 4 guys that can shoot the ball. So they can spread the defense out. So it's defense as much as offense.
Syracuse has not scored more than 61 points in any of their last 5 games. Here's Janine.
Well, Sean, this game could potentially be harder than the Duke game. That's what Jim Boeheim told his players. Maryland plays historically very tough here at home against top teams, and they've had a week to prepare. Meanwhile, in the 48 hours since Syracuse played Duke, the Syracuse players have received literally hundreds of text messages. But CJ Fair told me, we feel as a team that our coach was simply sticking up for us, and he was venting some built-up frustration. But Boeheim told his players, hey, if we want to be a good team, when things happen that are out of our control, when we're tested, we have to respond. Sean?
An interesting comment from C.J. Fair, because he's the one right after the game who made the point that if Boeheim had not received that technical, there was still the chance that Syracuse might have won, albeit slim. Mike Eads, the lead official, working with Tim Nestor and Jeffrey Anderson. Maryland in the home white uniforms, and Jake Lehman controlled the tip for the Terps.
Identification of a defense in basketball history. Syracuse starts in a 2-3 zone.
Come on. I don't believe it. Lehman, Evan Smotrich. They are the two leading 3-point threats against this zone defense. Lehman's first shot spun out to C.J. Fair. Now Tyler Ennis out there to start the game with Trevor Cooney, Rakeem Christmas, and Jeremy Grant.
Jake Lehman is guarding Trevor Cooney. That puts some size on him. Makes it more difficult for him to shoot over.
Bear has struggled offensively like most of his teammates lately. Misses his first shot.
It's so hard. You talk about beating a zone down the floor in transition, but it's hard to do. Syracuse does a good job of getting back. They're not easy to run on.
Held ball underneath. Charles Mitchell was tied up by C.J. Fair. We gave you the Syracuse starting lineup. Ennis, Cooney, Fair, Grant, and Christmas. the T-Rill Price starting lineup for Maryland. Seth Allen with Dez Wells, who's also been in a bit of a shooting slump lately. He's their leading scorer. Layman Smotrich and the big fella Charles Mitchell, who's had 12 points in each of their last two games. More of an offensive threat lately. Trevor Cooney trying to get it going and gets a friendly bounce. But Cooney went 9 of 12 from 3 against Notre Dame. And in the game since that game, he had only made 9 of 30 up until that last shot. So seeing the ball go through the net is a good start to this game for Cooney.
And that's in a stretch of 5. Those 9 threes. Trevor Cooney 1 for 9 in the last two games. And the response by Seth Allen. One of those players you mentioned, Jay, who can bury a three. He's made 33 this year, and he's only played in 15 games. He was injured, missed the first 12 with a fractured foot. Wells, the takeaway. The big guy, Mitchell, runs the floor.
Dez Wells doing a terrific job switching out on that play to get that steal and take it the other way for Mitchell.
Inside to Christmas, and he had it blocked. Mitchell fired up. And then Cooney, a steal. Intercepted the pass by Allen.
That's really what Syracuse needs to do, is get out in transition. Maryland got back and stopped it. But Maryland on the defensive end, trying to give whatever they help they can. They can switch off on Cooney. And they did. Layman switched off on Fair. Dez Wells jumps out, knocks it away, and pitches it ahead to Charles Mitchell, who in his last couple games is averaging 12.6 and a half rebounds. Mitchell has played strong and played well against Duke in a couple games ago. He had a really good game.
Cooney handed it off to Ennis from the free throw line. He knocks it home.
For Syracuse to reach its potential on the offensive end, Ennis has got to be more of a scorer. So he's a pass-first point, but he's got to start thinking score more often.
Well, they don't have enough consistent scoring options to get away with Ennis, who can score, not looking to score. Wells, way off from three. He came all the way out to Allen, and he traveled. Slipped. We've seen a couple of slips here in the first 3 minutes plus. Jim Boeheim, 945 wins, second all time behind Mike Krzyzewski. That win for Duke Saturday night was 979 for Coach K. Didn't take long, Syracuse in its first year in the ACC, to establish a rivalry with Duke.
It's really amazing how big that rivalry has become just in two games. It's a must-see game already.
Jeremy Grant, local player, homecoming for Jeremy. He's from not far down the road in Bowie, Maryland.
Want to make Jeremy Grant into a jump shooter, not a driver.
Allen, wide left with the three, and then a push-off on Charles Mitchell on the rebounding action.
And Grant is coming off a really good game that he had against Duke. 17 drives it. He likes to spin, as does CJ Fair. And you got to sit on that and keep him from driving. You have to close out short to a guy like Grant and invite him to take a jump shot, because he is so much better off the dribble.
Grant's 17 points Saturday night at Cameron led the Orange. Inside they go to Grant again.
Well, that's just too easy. First they run Cooney off a double screen low, then Fair. Then Fair goes off it again, and the screener is usually the guy that's open because they're so worried about CJ Fair. That was really well done by Syracuse.
Six unanswered points for Syracuse. Mitchell powers to the bucket, and it's blocked by Musakita, who has come in off the Syracuse bench.
Well, most teams want Jeremy Grant to take jump shots, but off that double stagger, he presents himself. Nice job by Musakita to screen off, and that is not a jump shot. That's a little more high percentage.
Well, these students were a couple of hours before the game tonight to practice that flash mob dance. And
they carried it off very well. Let's go inside the play with Syracuse leading 9-5.
Well, Syracuse brought Trevor Cooney and then C.J. Fair off a baseline double, and then Fair uses it again. He'll come off this double off the top of it, and that's going to force a switch. Evan Smotrich is going to switch off. Let's stop it right here. See, he's going to switch off onto Fair, and that means Des Wells needs to pick up Jeremy Grant, but they don't talk it. They don't communicate it. They both go with Fair, and that left Grant wide open for a dunk.
Syracuse has scored 6 unanswered points. They're 4 out of 6 from the field to start the game. Try to take advantage of a Maryland defense that has not been very good. Maryland gives up 70 points per game in ACC play. That's 11th in the league out of 15. Smotrich with the shot clock running out. Had it taken down by C.J. Fair.
It's so difficult to talk about penetrating a zone. But you penetrate into that Syracuse zone, you screen it and try to penetrate it. It is difficult. They're active, they're long-armed, and they're very athletic.
Couple of subs for Maryland. Nick Faust, number 5, in at guard. Demonte Dodd, the big fella right there under the basket, defending Grant as he went slicing to the bucket.
Much better job defending.
Faust passed up a 3. Smotrich takes a 3. And Musakita in good position. By had 9 rebounds in that loss Saturday at Cameron Indoor Stadium. Maryland just 1 out of 5 from 3-point range.
Team Christmas got into some early foul trouble, and Bimo Cicada played a lot of minutes and played well.
Fair, a deep 2. The homecoming for CJ Baltimore. Lifelong friend of Nick Faust of the Terrapins.
And although Fair made that jumper, that's not a shot you mind seeing him take. He's more dangerous when he puts it on the floor and attacks off the dribble.
There's the second 3 of the night for Maryland. Seth Allen ends the 8-0 Syracuse run.
Syracuse has given up some open shots at the top of that zone. They're going to run that same play that they just scored off of, that we just showed them inside the play. It's a different option to get it now to C.J. Fair on the opposite side of the floor and isolate it.
Cooney for 3. Wow, that barely hit anything. Rim or net.
He sets his feet so well. If you go underneath a screen or an exchange, or if you're late at all, he's going to pull up in good rhythm.
That is the second 3 for Cooney. He's 2 for 2. Now Ennis the steal. And the lay-in.
Tyler Ennis.
Doesn't look like Syracuse is suffering much of a hangover from the loss they had on Saturday, because this team has come out ready to play. And they're scoring off their defense. They've gotten some steals, some rebounds, and they've taken it the other way and gotten some good things.
They turned 4 Maryland turnovers into 9 points. Faust, a little too strong. Out of bounds, last touch by Syracuse.
A lot of times there have been screens on this zone. Ball screens trying to pass out of it like you would against a man-to-man. But you go underneath this exchange, Nick Faust goes underneath, you got no chance. I mean, you can defend him well and he'll still make a shot. But you go underneath and you're just handing it. It's like a layup for him.
Roddy Peters has come in, the freshman guard, number 2 for Maryland. Faust with a shot clock running out. Demonte Dodd missed the follow. Cooney feeling it early. That's his first miss from beyond the arc. And Jake Lehman won the battle. Syracuse with the 2 threes tonight has made as many as they've made in any of the last 3 games. They had exactly 2 made threes in each of the previous 3 games. And at the other end, another Maryland turnover as Faust lost it in the corner. Mark Turgeon in his 3rd year as head coach at Maryland. 25 wins a season ago. He'd like to get them into the NCAA tournament. He knows they have work to do if that's going to happen.
Well, and this is a great opportunity to get a quality win on that resume. And Mark Turgeon's an outstanding coach. Played at Kansas for Larry Brown. He's got his 300th win this year. Got it against Tulsa and Danny Manning, a college teammate of his with the Jayhawks.
Hand-checking foul called on his first, the team's 2nd.
This inbound, you always have to watch Cooney. He comes in quickly and can get a quick 3.
Hey, Michael Benajay off the Syracuse bench, number zero. Really their only depth of guard. For the most part, it's Ennis Cooney and Benajay in the backcourt, and that's it. Fair, another deep two, and wow, he is back on track
against his Baltimore buddy, Nick Faust. And Faust defended that well. That was a difficult shot. One dribble pull up, and that was the kind of shot he was hitting against Duke at the Carrier Dome when he had 28.
Smotridge rescued what was almost another Maryland turnover. Since that career-high game for Fair, Jay, the six games since, CJ has shot 37% from the floor. He's played a lot of minutes. Here's Ennis leading a Syracuse break. And Cooney threw it away. Intercepted by Peters, and Faust fouled hard on his way to the goal.
Well, Syracuse just turned it over. C.J. Fair trying to get back to stop it, but he has been more than fair to start this first half. Knocking down jumpers, one dribble, pull up off the exchange, and that was well defended. Just a terrific shot by an outstanding player.
We didn't used to do that in the other league. I shouldn't mention that, probably, right, Buck? I shouldn't mention that. We wouldn't do that. Yeah, I won't mention that. Oh, I did. Jeez. Can't help myself.
And by the other league, Jim Boeheim, of course, means the Big East, which Syracuse was in up until this year. Well, the ACC is aware of Jim Boeheim's comments, and I spoke to the ACC officials today who told me the two-day turnaround with the opponent, the other team, having a bye is not as uncommon as you would think. They cited six teams, Duke, North Carolina, Florida State, Virginia Tech, and NC State, that have all been in the same position within the last 3 years. They said there's a lot of teams to manage and a lot of TV networks as well. It's a lot to coordinate. Sean and Jay?
All right, Janine, thank you. Nick Faust misses the free throw. The foul just before the break on C.J. Fair, his first. I think Jim Boeheim's point, and it's true, back when they were in the Big East made it a point. If you were playing on Big Monday and you played Saturday, the team you were playing Monday also played Saturday. Not only did Syracuse play Saturday in that much anticipated and intense game against Duke, they played last Wednesday. So they played two games since Maryland last played here at home on Tuesday night against Wake Forest.
Yeah, it's just an issue of prep. And is it the end of the world? No, but you want to try to get it as level and even as you can. And now 1-3-1 for Maryland.
Benajay missed his first shot attempt. He had a nice night at Duke against his former team. He's a transfer to Syracuse from Duke. He scored 8 points at Cameron. And he's called for a reach-in foul there. Maryland took advantage of that extra time. Mark Turgeon gave his team 2 full days off this past Wednesday and Friday.
And Turgeon didn't like having that much time off. He wanted to play on Saturday.
And nobody's happy, Jim.
Yeah, nobody's happy, exactly. And you can understand some of the scheduling issues the coaches have that, you know, you're playing 4 games on the road out of 5 games. And it's not just that you're playing road games, because a lot of teams do that. It's who you're playing, because that's a big part of it.
Jake Lehman turned the corner into some traffic, and he was fouled. By Musakita, called for the foul, his first. Bracket Builder Week continues tomorrow night. Super Tuesday doubleheader at 7. Casey Crather at number 1 Florida take on Vanderbilt, followed by Indiana at number 14 Wisconsin. Wisconsin's had an up and down year.
Back up again, isn't it?
Yeah, all of a sudden they're going out of the rankings for a while. Now they're 14 in the poll that came out today. Florida topped that AP poll for the first time since 2007.
We've got Bracket Builder Week, and then we'll have very destructive. Then we'll have Bracket Buster Week. So we build it, then we bust it.
What we do in the media, we build people up, and then we tear them down, and then we build them back up again.
Back to man-to-man for Maryland. Gave a look at the 1-3-1 after the last timeout. Got a stop.
And Raheem Christmas was tangled up in the lane with Evan Smotridge. And Christmas got called for the foul. They were both pushing and shoving. And after a while,
he's dislodging. And, you know, I like that call by Mike Eads because a lot of officials would use the double foul there. You know, kind of send a message of, hey, knock it off and all that stuff. But I've never liked the double foul. A lot of officials will tell you it's a useful tool. But somebody started it.
Akeem Christmas called for his second foul. Those came quickly. And here's Mitchell. And if you have youngsters in the room, you may want to move them away from the TV set as he shoots a free throw. 34% for the year. And now four for his last 20.
Yeah, Charles Mitchell's made a lot of strides in becoming a better player. He's had some good games, especially of late. His last two averaged 12, but he needs to take a step forward here because with that body and the low post position he gets, he's going to get fouled a lot.
But if he took a step forward, he'd be across the free throw line. That would be a violation. Wouldn't count even if he made it.
Well, they're going back to that stagger where they bring C.J. Fair off after Trevor Cooney.
Cooney guarded by Lehman. And a good rebound in traffic. One-handed by Evan Smotrich.
Nice pass.
And Faust missed a three. Ennis, the rebound. Averages 3.5 rebounds per game. Of his guard position.
Ennis got it up the court quickly, and he did not hesitate to pull it back out when he didn't have exactly what he wanted.
He turns it over. That's a rarity. Fewer than two per game for Ennis. Allen picked it off. Sets up a three that wouldn't go for Lehman. Faust won the race to the ball. Smotrich a three.
Maryland needed that one.
Six unanswered for the Terps. And the sellout crowd fully engaged now. Fair.
How nice is that? A little step back dribble. Another one over Nick Faust. He's got the size advantage. But those are shots that he has not been hitting with regularity over his last five games.
And you wonder, because the Syracuse team isn't very deep, Jay, if fatigue is setting in. It seemed to happen to them at the end of the regular season last year, when just like this year, the offense went south. Allen, another three. His third three-pointer. He came into tonight's game three for his last 18 from three-point land. C.J. Fair from just inside the elbow.
Just a nice curl along that baseline screen. And he could have shot that right away, but it would have been challenged. Instead, he took his time. Allen. Well, the fakes are working against Syracuse. Seth Allen used one. Jake Lehman just there.
Wow, great defense as Lehman came to the jump stop. They just ripped it away from him. And a tip in, I believe, by Mai Musaketa, and a timeout called by Mark Turgeon. 30-second timeout. Back in 30 seconds.
Well, Maryland with a 7-point lead in this one, largely because of the play of C.J. Fair. Coming off screens, playing with great pace, and they have forced him into some jump shots, and he has been knocking those jump shots down. He has struggled from the field over his last five games or so, after he had 28 points and went 12 of 20 against Duke up at the Carrier Dome. And you mentioned it, Sean, the number of minutes that he has played. What did he do wrong to get taken out for 7 minutes?
Yeah, they've had so many close games, they don't have much depth. He's the ACC preseason player of the year. If you had to pick somebody to be the player of the year right now in the ACC, who would it be?
I think Jabari Parker has played extraordinarily well, especially over his last 10 games. I would put him right at the top of that list. It's still a long way to go.
A great effort by Musaketa. You could say that for 4 years. Gives them so much energy. 7 Maryland turnovers now. And it's a 7-point lead for the Cuse. Spare. Off the mark. Grant had inside position, but did wind up with the rebound. Des Wells for Faust. They been three-point happy have the Terrapins, and they haven't been turning it over. Lehman fell down but kept it alive, and then Allen traveled. And it's a media timeout with 6.5 to go in the first half. Syracuse leading Maryland 24-17. Sean McDonough back with our resident seer, Jay Billis, and Janine Edwards. Here's the resume for Syracuse, and right now, despite the two losses in a row, Joe Lenardi still has them as a number one seed for the NCAA tournament to begin today.
I think they are a number one seed. Syracuse has had a terrific season to date. They've got some very difficult games coming up, but right now, there can't be four teams that you would put ahead of Syracuse for a number one seed.
Fair has 10 points now and 4 rebounds. He's 5 out of 7 from the floor. And the lead to 9 for Syracuse. Their largest lead has been 10. Meanwhile, Maryland look inside more often. They've taken 17 shots. 11 of them have been threes.
Well, they need to get it into the middle. And if they can do that and then kick it out, then they'll have an opportunity. But you get it down along the baseline to Seth Allen. You know, Seth Allen is barely 6 feet tall. How's he going to score for Bagley, Cicada, and C.J. Fair? See, Fair setting the screen and then basically having an open side. He wants to get to that left hand, to that right shoulder. And even though Evan Smotrich came over, he did a nice job with his body control of getting that little short runner up.
After the 9th Maryland turnover, Syracuse back on offense. C.J. Fair called for an illegal screen. His second foul.
Just a little handoff action. He's got to come to a complete stop. Jim Boeheim telling him that right now. Just kind of a cheap foul that you don't want to pick up. They call it a 2-3 zone, but it's really a 2-2-1 the way they bring their wings up. They'll drop back down. They don't really match up out of it.
Nifty little floater by the freshman Roddy Peters. Highly touted prospect, missed a lot of his senior year of high school because of shoulder troubles. Ennis into the lane, inside position for Musiketa. And he finds a wide open Benajay. And Fair gets called for a push off. And now he's going to have to go to the bench. Mentioned. He's played all but a possible 7 minutes of the last 12 games. He has to come out now.
Looks like
and Jim Boeheim agitated for the first time tonight.
He had his elbow in the back of Des Wells. There was a push. Not much of one,
wow.
But he had his hands on his back. Difficulty for the official not to call that if he sees it.
Syracuse over the limit, so Des Wells makes the front end of a 1-1. 79% free throw shooter. Coach Boeheim wondering last night how the officiating might go tonight. A lot of times the belief around coaching is if you're particularly rough on an official, that perhaps his colleagues are going to rally to his aid the next time out and let you know. If you think you're going to get a favorable whistle tonight, forget about it. I think these guys have too much integrity to believe that. Coaches can be a paranoid lot. Cooney missed a three. And then a Maryland foul.
Maryland has done a pretty decent job with their first shot defense. But they've got to continue to rebound. It can't just. Guards have to get down and rebound as well.
Evan Smotrich, the foul, and he goes out. His second foul. Tyler Roberson in the game now. Doesn't play a lot. As a matter of fact, he hasn't played at all in the last two games against BC and Duke, but in there with the foul difficulty for Fair. And Ennis, nice little runner along the baseline.
How about the hesitation move he made? He's not got blazing speed, but the way he changes speeds gets him open.
He is the leader in this conference right now in assists per game and steals. Lehman missed the three. It got tipped out to Ennis. And if Ennis finishes the season leading the conference in assists and steals, he'd be the first freshman ever in this great basketball conference to lead the league in both of those categories.
Maryland switching those ball screens.
Wasn't on the same page with Benajay. Six Syracuse turnovers.
Tyler Ennis has turned the ball over a couple times. That has not been characteristic of his game, but that little hesitation move, that was a beautiful floater shot over Charles Mitchell. He's got game.
Sellout crowd here with the dignitaries. Boomer Esiason, legendary quarterback here at the University of Maryland in the early 80s. Proud Maryland graduate Scott Van Pelt, our ESPN colleague on TV at ESPN Radio. 16 NBA types here tonight, including, in my opinion, the leading candidate for executive of the year in the NBA, Phoenix Suns general manager Ryan McDonough.
Well, this is one where I might actually agree with you. The general manager of, as you refer to it, America's team.
Yes, the Phoenix Suns. Tough loss for the Suns last night at ESPN. Mitchell a couple of chances in close and couldn't finish for the Terrapins.
Boy, strong move by Mitchell. And that's one that he does need to finish, but it is difficult to finish over by Musakita. He is an excellent shot blocker and does a good job of challenging shots.
Ennis, it caromed off to Mitchell. Seth Allen, and a transition three and an air ball from Faust, coming off a career high 20 points last Tuesday night in their win here against Wake Forest. And Benajay too anxious to get moving. Tomorrow ESPN 2 features undefeated Wichita State, ranked number 2 in the country. They're on the road to take on Bradley. Wichita State versus Bradley Tuesday night at 9 on ESPN 2. Also live on Watch ESPN.
Wichita State now 29-0. And they're playing for history. And I don't think it's something that should necessarily put pressure on them, but something they should pursue.
And a three for Seth Allen, his fourth.
He's been the entire offense for Maryland.
That's half of their points, 2.5 to go. Syracuse will likely play the rest of the first half without C.J. Fair on the bench with three fouls.
Maryland switching, and they can give a little bit of space. See, that's not a good play by Des Wells. You got to make Roberson shoot that ball.
Roberson forced it. Faust turned it over. Maryland keeps throwing it away, and yet down by just four. Benajay nearly traveled again and then got fouled on his drive into the lane. Mark Turgeon didn't like the call. Here's Gene Edwards.
Well, Sean, Mark Turgeon told us today that on Thursday he came up with the game plan for tonight's game by watching last year's Big East Championship in which Louisville beat Syracuse. He said he stole a couple of things from Rick Pitino. So far, he's very happy with the way his team is executing that game plan. But what's really getting him annoyed is that they're not fighting hard enough for 50-50 balls, and they keep turning it over. They have 10 turnovers, yet they're only down by four. But he is happy with the way they're executing so far offensively, guys.
Well, that's one of the issues, Janine, is their turnovers, because they're playing a little bit too fast. They've taken some quick shots in transition, trying to make something happen. They've been loose with the ball. What Janine was talking about there, that's a Rick Pitino ran a little 1-4 set where the elbows, you get the ball to one elbow, the other big would dive. They haven't really run that in this game yet. Maybe we will see it, but they haven't really run it yet.
And Mark Turgeon said Michigan ran some of that same action in the Final Four game against Syracuse in Atlanta.
You really have to have big guys to run that. It can be difficult when you don't.
Full shot clock for Syracuse. Three bench players on the court in Benajay, Roberson, and Musakita, along with Ennis and Cooney.
Roberson, Keita just being used as screeners right now and running cutters off of them. When Cooney sets a screen, he could be especially dangerous.
Cooney missed the three. Des Wells has Faust ahead, and Faust has it go off his hand and out of bounds. Looked like he was turning to look at the basket. The pass was a bit high. It's the 11th turnover for Maryland.
It looked like it was a bit behind him. And that's one where you didn't have to give it up quite that early. That's a difficult pass when you're on a dead run to catch. It was a two-on-one. And take it a little further and put Cooney in a position to foul. You can take it all the way to the free throw line. As long as you use that free throw line like a stop sign, you can put a lot of pressure on your opponent in a fast break situation.
Roberson fouled. And he'll go to the line to shoot a pair.
Without C.J. Fair in the ballgame, Syracuse's half-court offense has really ground to a halt. Mm-hmm. They've not been able to get anything, but Maryland can't take advantage of it. They've had some transition opportunities, they've had some shots, and they haven't gotten anything.
Roberson's a freshman from Union, New Jersey. Limited experience at the line, just 16 attempts prior to tonight. He'd made 12 of them. 75%. First free throw of the night for Syracuse. And they're now one out of two. You wonder if there's something wrong with Jeremy Grant, Jay. We saw him stretching, the medical staff looking at him earlier. Played only 11 minutes in this first half.
Well, it's his back. He had a back issue against Duke. He was stretching out in that ball game, but he played basically the whole game and really gutted it out. But you could tell when he came back from halftime in that ball game that he was really bothered. You know, at times Maryland's going too fast, and at other times they're going too slow. And that was a really poor pass. The turnovers right now are killing the Terps.
12 of them, and yet within five against this Syracuse team that once again is struggling to score. They got off to a fast start offensively. But as the half's gone on, it's looked more and more like the last five games for the Orange. Nice pass inside. They're going to wave off the goal, saying that Bayo Musiketa was fouled before the shot.
Well, Dodd just didn't get up top. It just got sealed off. He should have been right in the middle of the lane. That was just essentially a freshman mistake defensively, and Tyler Ennis took advantage of it.
Monte Dodd, the freshman, called for his first foul. Just the sixth on the team since it wasn't in the act of shooting. Syracuse will play it in. They can take the last shot of the half now. The shot clock off with 22 seconds to go.
The guy you want shooting this is Cooney if you can get him an open shot. They'll go to a 1-4 low. And if Ennis takes it to the right side off this ball screen.
Need a shot. Ennis deep three. Rattles one home at the buzzer.
Kid's got ice water in his veins. Didn't panic, couldn't get it to Cooney. They tried to. He cracked a smile, though. He is human. What a player.
Jim Boeheim in conversation with Mike Eads, one of the officials on the way off the court.
Seth Allen ran right into that screen. Dodd came out to try to bother that shot, but nothing bothered Tyler Ennis.
Finishes the first half, does Ennis, with 9 points. At the half, the Cuse by eight. Welcome back to Big Monday, presented by Verizon, a big part of Bracket Builder Week. You're watching the ACC on ESPN. Syracuse in its first season in the ACC. Maryland in its last. So this will be their only regular season meeting as members of the same conference, at least for the foreseeable future. Syracuse leads by eight at the break. And number of problems for Maryland, Jay, in that half. The turnovers jump right off the page. It is indeed Big Monday. And they need to get their leading scorers, Wells and Lehman, more involved.
Yeah, Des Wells and Jake Lehman, the two leading scorers, combined for 4 points. They were 0 of 4 from the field. They do have to get more involved. And Des Wells has had some excellent second halves. He had 17 in the second half against Duke, 21 against Miami. But C.J. Fair was terrific to start this ball game off. He got in some foul trouble, picked up his third. Played 15 minutes in that first half. He went 5 of 7 from the field. He had 10 points. That went along with a 9-point first half for Tyler Ennis, who went 4 of 7 from the field. There's the second foul that C.J. Fair picked up, a moving screen on a little handoff. He's back into the ball game now, has to be a little more judicious about picking up that foul. Syracuse scored 19 points off of 12 Maryland turnovers, and Syracuse, one of the best teams in the country at scoring off of turnovers. They average over 16 a game. They've already got 19.
in there to start the second half. Syracuse actually outscored Maryland 6-5 over the final 5 minutes of the first half without C.J. Fair in the game. Seth Gallagher bumped on the drive by Trevor Cooney, and here's Janine Edwards.
Well, guys, Syracuse associate head coach Mike Hopkins told me that defense is what it's all about. He said that's been our anchor all year, and it's got to continue to be our anchor. We have to continue to play smart on D, and we cannot lose sight of their shooters, Seth Allen in particular. And even though C.J. Fair is in that foul trouble, he said we still have to play strong around the basket because those rebounds help us get back in transition.
Seth Allen was 4 out of 5 from the floor in the first half, all of them threes. Smotridge a miss, out of bounds to Syracuse. The rest of the Maryland team had just 12 points on 3 out of 17 shooting.
And they've gotten some open shots. That was a good skip pass from the left side of the court to the right. And Evan Smotridge had a good opening there. A little 1-2-2, three-quarter court press right now, 1-2-1-1. Slow the advance a little bit, see if you can pick up a turnover. Maryland picks up a foul.
Sean,
Jeremy
Grant
first. Jeremy Grant still out of the ballgame.
I think there's something wrong with that back. He'd be in there to start the second half.
With the lead, Jim Boeheim can give him some rest and try to get him right as they go forward. But he played through that pain against Duke. He played just about the whole game.
Dennis Cooney, Fair, Christmas, and Benajay start the second half. A small lineup for Syracuse. Fair the miss, Smotridge the rebound. Janine has more on Jeremy Grant.
Yes, guys, the team told me that they were working the entire halftime on his back, stretching him out. His back is bothering him. He is available, but he's not playing right now. Obviously, they're going to hold him as long as they can.
And after another Maryland turnover, Fair the dunk. He's 6 out of 8 from the floor. And the lead is up to 10. That matches the biggest lead of the night for the Orange.
A smart play by Trevor Cooney. He could have thrown that ball ahead, but took his time and really surveyed the situation. He's got good vision as a passer.
Mitchell made a nice move to the bucket, then missed a short shot. Cooney, a very deep three. Christmas awkwardly managed to come down with that ball. Cooney, a better look. And a push underneath against Maryland.
Well, Maryland has not done themselves any favors with all of these turnovers. Coming off that ball screen, just a weak pass. You don't throw a bounce pass out front like that. And even though Cooney could have thrown that ball ahead, the right thing to do was to pull it up and wait for C.J. Fair to come down the floor for that easy finish. That was well done by Trevor Cooney.
Last foul was on. Very nearly picked up his third. See, poke that pass away from Rakeem Christmas. Jim Boeheim down the bench talking to Jeremy Grant for a moment, but he's not moving toward coming into the game.
Really nobody flashing into the middle for Maryland.
Wells, the floater, gets it to go.
That's what Wells is best at. He's a driver, and you have to play him as such. He's made 15 threes on the year, but he's more dangerous as a transition finisher and driving the ball. But I think they can get him into the middle, give him the ball, and he can make a play in there.
And more foul difficulty now for Syracuse. Rakeem Christmas called for his third foul as he tried to set up in the lane.
That is not what Syracuse wants at the top of that zone. You want to get out and take that drive away and at least stunt to try to stop that drive.
Seth Allen, Jake Lehman, Evan Smotridge, Des Wells and Nick Faust for the University of Maryland, 15 and 12 for the year. Their best wins, Florida State and Providence. They need some marquee wins down the stretch. Wells to the goal. Back-to-back buckets for the junior from Raleigh, North Carolina. Benajay trying to throw it down from long range. He got bailed out by a foul call. Underby would have been able to dunk it had he not been hit from as far from the bucket as he was when he took off.
Looked like he took off just to get that foul.
Reaching for the basket. Blake Griffin can do that. I'm not sure if Michael Benajay can.
At least he picked up the foul. But there's what we were talking about before, Sean. The driving ability of Des Wells, who transferred in after being dismissed
from the University of Xavier.
Christmas to the bench with his three fouls. Benajay made the first free throw. Smotrich the foul, his third. The second one popped out. Finally, Sakita has come in for Christmas.
Charles Mitchell down low, staying behind the zone. If he can screen the middleman, lay his body on someone in that zone, he can create an opening for a teammate. But right now, he's just kind of staying along the baseline.
Bad pass again. And C.J. Fair almost had the pickoff. Seconds on the shot clock.
Lehman has got to find a way to get open. With his length and his ability to shoot, he's got to be more of a threat out there.
Taking only three shots, hasn't made one. Wells a three that came out. Benajay had it, stripped by Faust. And then when Faust went to the floor, he Dennis. Whirling to the bucket, then missed the short one-hander.
Turned around like he was going to give it to Cooney for a three. Everybody went with Cooney, and he was wide open.
4 minutes gone by, second half. Syracuse by seven. Allen called for carrying the basketball. And a timeout. Welcome back to College Park, Maryland. It's Bracket Builder Week, and Maryland really needs to enhance its resume at 15 and 12 overall.
Well, you can see their RPI rank and their BPI rank. ESPN's Basketball Power Index has a lot more variables that go into the rankings, and I think a more accurate indicator of where Maryland ranks among the 351 division teams is that 50. But Maryland has played a good schedule, but the only quality wins on that schedule against Providence and Florida State. The Terps could use a win like this to add to that resume.
Virginia coming here before the end of the regular season as well. The ACC tournament will provide an opportunity, one would think, to beat a quality opponent or more. Ennis, an open three, and he knocked it home. Not really his game. Made only 2 3-point field goals in the last seven games. He has 12 points tonight.
And he gets that much time. That was an awful lot of time to set your feet and go up for a three off a simple little drive from the left side by Benajay.
Wells trying to find a spot in which to shoot. It's tipped up and in by Charles Mitchell, the 6'8 sophomore from Atlanta.
Even Sean, with all these turnovers, and there have been a ton of them for Maryland, they are still within striking distance in this ballgame.
Cooney. Ennis anticipated where that ball was going to be. It's as if somebody told him it's going to wind up right in the middle of the lane. He started sprinting toward the middle of the lane before the ball was even heading in that direction, it seemed.
Well, Jake Lehman tried to tip it to a teammate, but you don't want to tip it to your opponent's basket. You want to tip it out or grab it.
There's been more points in this game scored off turnovers by the two teams combined than not off turnovers.
Cooney with the drive. Lehman tries to tip it down underneath. And Cooney, what a great play on his back. Able to get to a cutting Tyler Ennis.
Keel Clare has come in. Here was number 44. Is up high. Benajay getting a lot of minutes without Grandin there tonight. Nice drive and missed the left-handed layup.
That was a pretty good job in transition defense to stop the ball by Syracuse.
Cooney's going to be called for a foul, and apparently he got hit in the face as he leaned in. He got called for his second. Three team fouls on Syracuse here in the second half, leading by 10. Which matches their largest lead of the night. Maryland led by two very early in the first half.
Still Lehman, there's not much movement on the part of Jake Lehman. He's got to find an open. He's just going to stand. They're going to be able to recover him. He's too good of a shooter not to have a field goal at this point.
can't get one to go. You know he wants to have a good night. Everybody wants to have a good night every night. But his parents are here from Massachusetts tonight, Tim and Claire Lehman. They don't get to many Maryland home games. They have four other boys. Allen among the tall trees and the rebound down to Fair. The student section behind us thought he was hit on the drive.
Tatum went straight up. Straight up, you're entitled to that space all the way to the ceiling. But it was a good drive. Great lift and hesitation move by Seth Allen.
Bear working on Lehman. And then Wells came over to swat it away. Jim Boeheim thought Bear was fouled, and Cooney kicked it. So Maryland will keep it with exactly 13 minutes remaining.
Well, Maryland keeps it, but that was an opportunity to get a layup. Lehman goes up, is knocked away by Des Wells, who came in, not too worried about a shooter on that side of the floor. Good pass, got to catch that.
16 turnovers. Shaquille Clear couldn't catch that one. Mark Turgeon looking for a shoulder to cry on. He turns to his outstanding assistant, Scott Spinelli. Been with Mark for a long time back to the A&M days. Vinajay, a miss. Faust leading the break. Wells tried to throw it down, and it was challenged by Vinajay.
That was a terrific pass, and that layup just taken away by Vinajay, who went up,
wow,
and just knocked it out of Des Wells' hand. That is not easy to do. Didn't look like he got much arm. That was all ball. What a great play by Mike Vinajay. Allen's flashing through into the middle, but only Smotrich stopped, and it's available there to get it. He hooked. That's
he did a good call by Jeff Anderson. Smotrich clearly used that free arm. A swim move, and it's his fourth foul.
Des Wells cut through there, then Lehman, but they didn't stay there. And Smotrich was able to get the ball just using that hook, which is an offensive foul, correctly called. And yet another turnover for Maryland. They've not put a whole lot of pressure on this Syracuse defense. They've had their chances.
Maryland has turned it over 17 times. They've made only 10 field goals. That's not a good ratio. Wow. Syracuse very lucky there that that ball did go out of bounds, because they were all just anticipating it was going to go out of bounds and didn't run after it. Had it stayed in, Faust would have had an uncontested layup.
That's the kind of luck Maryland has had. That ball goes out of bounds. It's Maryland's ball. Instead, they try to make a play.
Apparently his foot was out of bounds, but the ball wasn't. John McDonough, Jay Billis, Janine Edwards. Back in College Park, Maryland. Big Monday presented by Verizon. The start of Bracket Builder Week. Syracuse scoring points in transition off a lot of Maryland turnovers.
24 points off of turnovers. Maryland's coughed it up 17 times. And that has certainly made the Syracuse offense look much better. But Syracuse has played better in the half court when C.J. Fair has been in there. Fair had three fouls in that first half. Didn't play as many minutes as he would have normally. But he's 6 of 10 from the field. He's got 6 rebounds, 12 points in his 23 minutes. He's had a terrific game. Again.
Tyler Ennis guarded by Seth Allen. Man-to-man for Maryland. And Ennis. A little step back from the left side of the lane.
They keep running that little double along the baseline. They bring Cooney off it. Then they bring C.J. Fair off it, and that really opens things up. If you don't put a lot of pressure on Tyler Ennis, you kind of blow that play up, and he can even take it on his own like he did there.
Allen, the long three. Lehman tried to tip it out. It was grabbed by Ennis. Largest lead of the night for Syracuse, 12 points, and a chance to build on it.
Syracuse could have taken that the other way. There were four guys in white shirts that went after the offensive glass. Still going back to the same play. Maryland has not defended it as well as they need to.
There, no. By Musakeda on the offensive glass. Jim Boeheim thought he was fouled. seems, Jay, as teams do a better and better job of staying with Cooney and defending him well, he's moving further and further away from the three-point line.
Yeah, but he's taken a lot of deep ones. That's a good point. But he has taken a lot of deep ones over the course of the year. He's just not making them. I mean, he's 2 for 8 in this game, and he got off to a pretty good start. But he's actually gotten more open looks in this one than he has over the last 4 or 5 games. That's a bad foul by Tyler Ennis right there to foul a three-point shooter.
Syracuse foul number 3 on number 11, Tyler Ennis, his first personal.
One of the ways that Cooney gets in rhythm in a ball game is when he hits an open shot in transition or off an offensive rebound. And that was essentially a reversal off an offensive rebound. And Cooney stepped into that one. He's just got to make them.
First foul on Ennis. Allen makes the free throw. Sophomore from Woodbridge, Virginia.
Maryland missed so many games with that broken foot. They had to learn. Maryland had to learn to play without him. And then he comes back, and then they've got to learn to play with him. There's been a real lack of continuity due to that injury in this whole season. They weren't a very powerful offensive team without him. They're certainly much better with him on the offensive end.
He has 14 points tonight. The average is 12 a game. Syracuse by 10 nearly midway through the second half. Fair had a little room. Wells really didn't stay up on him. And C.J. Fair said, I'll take it. And he made it.
C.J. Fair catches the ball and he doesn't make a quick decision. He surveys things and looked down. Des Wells backed up to play the drive. He took that jumper.
Strong move to the goal by Wells, and Mark Turgeon uses a quick timeout.
See Fair when he catches this ball after setting a screen, little exchange, crossing under. He just kind of looks down, gives a little shot fake, and freezes Wells, and then knocks it down. He has really had a terrific offensive game.
The last remaining undefeated team in college basketball headlines ESPN's Journey to the Tourney. Number 2, Wichita State, now 29-0, trying to remain perfect when they go on the road to face Bradley, which has lost the last 11 head-to-head against the Shockers. That's the Journey to the Tourney tomorrow night at 9 on ESPN2, also live on Watch ESPN. Some would say they're undefeated. Why aren't they number 1 in the country instead of number 2?
You know, Wichita State, if they stay unbeaten, they'll probably be number 1 in the country and perhaps the number 1 overall seed headed into the NCAA tournament. Because I think there's a game before the end of the season.
You think they are a number 1 seed with the tournament began today?
No question. No question. I think you have to honor that undefeated season, even though they haven't played the same kind of schedule. Just like it was done with Gonzaga last year when Gonzaga was the number 1 overall seed.
Ennis rattles out to Des Wells. He is the only Maryland player who has a field goal here in the second half.
Maryland's got to get something going. And they're down 10 in this one, but they get a score, a stop, and a score. This game's going to look a lot different and feel a lot different. Crowd will get into it.
Allen, another 3. His first of the half, his 5th of the night. They're within 7.
Nice job screening the top of the zone.
Ennis off for Fair. Wide open Benajay. And he rattles home a 3.
That's quite an answer on the road. Benajay, as you mentioned, Sean, played very well at Duke. He transferred from Duke to Syracuse. Had a nice night back in Cameron Indoor Stadium for the first time since he left. Lob.
Or Faust, a little too high from Allen. A low percentage play there, down by 10 with the clock running out. Ennis a miss. Wound up with Cooney. Fair again, took a look at the defender and shot an air ball. $17,950 here at the Comcast Center. That's the first sellout of the year. At home for Maryland. Ennis pushes the lead back up to 12.
What a great pivot. He got Jake Lehman on him on the switch. Took him right, pivoted back, and shot over him. That was a big-time play by Tyler Ennis. Nothing rattles that guy ever. I wonder if he's ever piloted an airplane. Could use him in the morning. There aren't many freshmen in the country that show the poise as consistently as Tyler Ennis does. Nothing shakes this guy. That's a big-time move. Might have gotten away with a little shuffle, but that's okay. Nobody saw it.
Syracuse has its sights set on an ACC championship in their first year in the conference. Kind of remain a game behind Virginia with a head-to-head matchup coming Saturday. And C.J. Fair and Tyler Ennis leading the way to a 12-point lead over Maryland tonight.
Well, before the game, Sean, we talked about Tyler Ennis having to take on more of a scoring load in this ball game, especially with Jeremy Grant out of the game with those back issues.
Very nice interior pass by Demonte Dodd, and it'll lead to two free throws.
Syracuse hasn't shot well in this second half, but they have gotten a number of offensive rebounds to extend their possessions. Maryland can clean those up with defensive boards. They got a chance to get back in it.
And Syracuse had seven offensive rebounds in this half. Jay called for the foul. Excuse me, Jay, his second.
That's really Syracuse's game. Points in transition and points off their defense. And then second chance points. One of the better offensive rebounding teams in the country. Got about 40% of their misses on the season.
Ronnie Peters, the freshman, misses both. He's 66% for the year. Maryland tonight just 7 out of 13 from the line. And Ennis missed the layup. Peters has a man ahead of the field and couldn't get it to Faust. Clooney intercepted. Under 7 minutes to go.
Maryland sees an opening in transition, and they've had plenty of them. And those openings have closed up quickly. What looks like should be a layup or a foul for Maryland has turned into a turnover, and Syracuse taking it the other way. And those turnovers have been really difficult. Taking total control of this game.
Ennis fading away three with about 7 on the shot clock. Peters underneath the Faust. And he's fouled as he went up. Benajay called for his third foul. The doubleheader of NBA basketball Wednesday night on ESPN. At 8, Anthony Davis and the Pelicans face the Mavs. And then at 10:30, Dwight Howard leads the Rockets back into the Staples Center to take on Chris Paul and the Clippers. NBA Wednesday presented by State Farm. Starting the key NBA countdown, 7:30 on ESPN. Mentioned, we're told about 16 NBA scouts. I think there might be more than that.
There are more than
the number of folks that we've recognized.
Tim Hardaway, B.J. Johnson, Danny Ferry, his father Bob Ferry.
Syracuse handled the pressure. Now Clooney wanted to attack, and Smotridge got in the way. And he is fouled out. And not a good night for Evan Smotridge. Just 3 points, 3 rebounds.
He struggled over his last 4 games coming into this one. He's 9 of 37 and 2 of 19 from 3 coming into this game. And he struggled again in this one. He just needs something to go down because he's a skilled player.
3 points and 3 rebounds tonight. He averages 11 points and 6 rebounds. Made 1 3-pointer in 4 tries. 6 minutes to go now. Been right around this margin throughout the second half for Syracuse, right around 10 points.
Syracuse hasn't had a whole lot of game pressure. They've been able to play with the lead for this entire ball game.
Jim Boeheim was certainly willing to run some clock even with this much time left. Ennis, another tough shot. He has 20. Fourth time this season he's had 20 or more. His high is 28.
Got that at Maui, if I remember right. But he went right into the chest of Nick Faust and then just took a little step back. That was a big-time move.
Wells fouled.
This shows some pace and also some strength. No, it was Seth Allen he went into, but just knocked him back. He's bigger than Allen. Just knocked him straight back.
and stepped back a little bit, created that space. There's that demeanor that never changes. He'd be tough to play poker with.
Wells missed the first free throw. 20 points on 50% shooting. Five games. He's one of those guys who never looks like he's tired, but you wonder about fatigue for him because he, like C.J. Fair, plays just about every minute of every game for Syracuse. Cooney has another open look, and after a 2-for-2 start from beyond the arc, he's gone ice cold. Wells, and it is a blocking foul called on Ennis. His second foul.
Well, Trevor Cooney isn't going to get a more wide-open shot. And usually when he gets those, he absolutely drills them. He's not shot the ball particularly well of late.
Missed his last 7 three-point field goals.
Well, and he is on. Remember the show he put on in the Carrier Dome after that epic game they had against Duke? In a classic, what you would think would be a classic letdown game where it would be difficult to get motivated.
CJ 33 points.
He went 9 of 12 from 3, and CJ Fair struggled. Nobody else could score. I mean, he bailed him out.
Yeah, they needed all 33 because they only scored 61 as a team in that big Monday 61-55 win over Notre Dame. 13 points now for Des Wells. Deficit down to single digits now, and Jim Boeheim's going to call a timeout with 5:04 remaining.
As poorly as Maryland has played and taken care of the ball with all these turnovers, there's still plenty of time left, and they're only 3 possessions down.
Now we have a moment. Let's check the ACC standing. Syracuse, until this week, leading the ACC all season long without a loss. The home loss to Boston College last Wednesday, the loss at Duke on Saturday, and now it's Virginia leading the way, and it'll be Syracuse in Virginia Saturday in Charlottesville. Syracuse can win this game. It sets up a mammoth matchup at John Paul Jones Arena,
and that's why this game is so important. It keeps Syracuse in the running with Virginia, and Virginia's had a fabulous year. I mean, they started out the season a little bit shaky, lost to Green Bay, they had some difficulties to start the year, but Malcolm Brogdon, who's back from an injury from last year, has been all ACC caliber. He's played extraordinarily well. You know, the other team that has really impressed of late, Duke has played very well, but North Carolina has shown an awful lot of fight.
Virginia's won 11 in a row. Out of bounds, Maryland ball. So a chance to really tighten it up now.
Des Wells did a nice job of contesting that shot by C.J. Fair.
Lehman, can he finally make one? Yes, he can. And the crowd fully engaged with the Terps within 6. By Ennis. And a Syracuse foul. 6-0 run and a chance to extend it for Maryland. C.J. Fair called for the foul. And that is his 4th.
That is exactly, Sean, what Maryland needed. Benajay comes up from the corner to try to put pressure. That left Lehman open, and the middle guy's got to come all the way over. And a little bit of a deflection there and a foul by C.J. Fair from behind. And all of a sudden, there's some game pressure on Syracuse and some life in the Terps and life in this building.
Now 3 out of 4 from the line. This is a 1-1. Just 63% as a team tonight. 12 out of 19. He makes the first. And for C.J. Fair and the Syracuse Orange, another low-scoring seat squirmer. In a season filled with a lot of them, particularly lately. This is the closest Maryland has been in the second half. They're down by 8 at the break.
You got to think they're going to look to C.J. Fair.
Guard to Syracuse lead was 12. Ennis shut off by Faust. Shot clock down to 10. Ennis needs to generate something. Fair step back that popped in and out. 4 minutes to go. Maryland within 4.
wings are all the way up, but there's nobody in the corner.
Allen passed up a deep three into the lane and swatted by Christmas with help from Benajek.
It's awfully tough to ask your point guard to drive in and score over the size of Syracuse.
Again, Syracuse going to milk the clock. C.J. Fair. Double team. Not a lot of scoring options out there for Syracuse, with Clooney struggling. With Christmas and Benajay on the court. Fair! Oh. Rattles home a three, stepping back to right in front of his own bench.
Boy, what a difficult shot that C.J. Fair just nailed there. That was huge.
Timeout Maryland. With Syracuse on the ropes. C.J. Fair, the senior, with what might be one of the big buckets of this season for Syracuse.
Down toward the end of the clock. That must have been let go with two or one on it. And he just drilled it. That was a difficult shot. Just that little step back created the space, and Des Wells was right there to contest it.
I mentioned earlier, Jay, he was the preseason player of the year. C.J. Fair came back for his senior season. How would you evaluate the year he had? One area that's really fallen off is three-point shooting. Last year, 47% from beyond the arc. Didn't shoot a ton of them. He shot more of them this year, down to 27%.
Probably had a few more weapons around him last year, guys that could score. This year, he's the lead dog and the number one guy in the scouting report. And he's not... C.J. Fair's had a fabulous career at Syracuse. He's an outstanding player, but not a guy that you would expect to go out and score 20 points a game. That's not the kind of player he is. So he needs some help. And that's why I think Tyler Ennis has to become more of a scorer. Now, Trevor Clooney's gotten a lot of open shots that I think normally he would nail. But he's been struggling a little bit from the field. He'll start hitting those shots. But if he'd hit those, then we'd have a wider margin. Maryland needs to answer right here. They need a bucket.
Well, that took the crowd out of it. That big basket by C.J. Fair. Seth Allen trying to bring him back in. Six three-pointers for Allen. Clooney wondering if he should attack. One eye on the bucket, one eye on Coach Boeheim, and they bring it back out with a four-point lead and 2:17 to go. They can take it under 2 minutes.
Forcing a jump shot. And a big defensive rebound is what Maryland needs here. But Jim Boeheim content to run some clock and let Tyler Ennis make a decision. And he usually makes the right one.
Five on the clock. Two to shoot. Cooney, tough one. Oh. Yes! Wow. Talk about the right time to break out of a long slump in this game.
Well, that's how you do it. You take a shot, a fadeaway jumper like that. What a tough shot.
Allen. Fouled by Rakeem Christmas.
Syracuse foul.
That's four fouls on Christmas, so foul difficulties on both sides.
Des Wells with a nice drive and pass, and Seth Allen able to knock that shot down to put some pressure on Syracuse. But the answer from Trevor Cooney, what a shot!
Here, Reese and Seth Allen at the free throw line. Out of the timeout. He's made it a 5-point game. The foul before the break on his fourth. He's still out there. C.J. Fair also playing with four fouls. 22 points for Seth Allen. And more pressure in the backcourt for Maryland. Syracuse handles it again.
Maryland does not have to gamble here. Play straight up. Force a challenge shot and rebound it.
Last Syracuse possession, the huge bucket by Cooney at the end of the shot clock. He had missed his previous nine shots. C.J. Fair, prior to that, a big three at the end of the shot clock. Can they do it again? Cooney, not this time. Battle for the rebound, and it's scooped up by Charles Mitchell. Ticking down near 1 minute to go. Syracuse by four.
necessarily have to have a three here, but that is the type of shot that will be available against the zone.
Wells aggressively into the lane, and he's fouled.
Des Wells having another terrific second half. He's been much more aggressive attacking off the dribble. He's a driver first and does a great job of getting to the free throw line. He only had 2 points in that first half, not a single field goal.
He's put up fouls on Binajay now as well.
Wells has put up double figures in the second half. He's been a big factor in this comeback by Maryland. And his defense has been good. Even though C.J. Fair has scored over him several times, he's made him take some difficult shots. Fair's just made him. He's been terrific.
Here is Wells. 5 out of 6 from the line. Wow, what a lucky bounce. Hit the back of the rim, sort of on the left side of it. Up in the air and through. And now a chance to get them within two. The last time they were within two was when it was 7-5. In the opening moments. Nothing but net with that one. 13 points in this half for Des Wells. And Lehman got a hand on the pass. And he missed the layup. Got it back. And a foul call. And it's on Binajay, I believe, who's just fouled out.
Lehman with his length out front in that 1-2-1-1. Just able to get a piece of it. And stuck with it in order to get it back before being fouled by Binajay. And now he's going to get an opportunity to tie this ball game. Looked initially like he might have walked, but the problem was he didn't have the basketball in order to walk. Didn't have possession of it, but fought hard to get it. And then got it off the backboard. Great play by Lehman.
Time for Did You See That? Brought to you by Verizon. And it's the Maryland comeback. Sellout crowd right now.
And when Maryland stopped turning the ball over and made good passes and got good shots, there's Lehman in the corner. Seth Allen has hit tough shots. They have done a really good job of attacking and getting to the free throw line in the last 5 minutes.
Now Lehman can tie the game. In and out for the sophomore from Wrentham, Massachusetts.
Didn't make or a miss. Maryland's got to consider fouling here to extend the game. Syracuse can't just walk the ball around.
By Musiketa on the floor with Christmas, Cooney, Fair and Ennis. They'd like to keep it away with Syracuse from Musiketa's. Not a good free throw shooter. 6 of the previous 7 Syracuse games decided by 6 points or less. And here's another, it seems. Unless we go to overtime. Unlikely one team's going to win by more than 6 in regulation. Timeout with 15 to shoot, 27.6. On the game clock. Tomorrow night, the only undefeated team remaining in the country, number 2, Wichita State, takes on Bradley. The 9. ESPN 2, Wichita State. They can win its 2 remaining regular season games. Be the first team since St. Joe's in 04 to go into their conference tournament undefeated. But what do you look for down the stretch here now? Jim Boeheim needs to dial something up with his team, kind of hanging on for dear life right now.
Well, they can take the shot clock all the way down because there's some time. There's 11 second difference. So as long as you let it go around 13, 14, you'll have plenty of time to get an offensive rebound. But you want to take it down as far as you can if Maryland will let you. And so far, they have let them. If Syracuse is able to hit a 3 here, it's essentially game over. But I think they'll go to C.J. Fair. It'll be in Ennis's hands, and they'll look to get it to Fair.
Tyler Ennis, Maryland man-to-man. In it goes to Fair, guarded by Wells. 5 to shoot, Fair long 2, short, rebound Wells. Chance to win it on this possession for Maryland. Faust attacks the bucket. Blocked by Musakita. Fair has the ball. Off to Ennis, and they grab him. Mark Turgeon almost out to the elbow. He thought there was a foul underneath on the block by Musakita. That's just the 16th foul on Maryland, which is unfortunate for Coach Turgeon because they have to foul again.
Able to get the ball into C.J. Fair. Des Wells again forced another difficult shot. And Maryland had a great opportunity in transition, but Syracuse really did a good job of defending in transition. By Musakita there, didn't look like a foul, but it was certainly.
Now, Mark Turgeon, he holds his ground. And if that had been called a foul, we would have seen Jim Boeheim's Pilates part two. Mark Turgeon came almost all the way out to the elbow. You know, they keep talking about cleaning up bench decorum and the behavior of the coaches. You can't allow that. I know he's trying to get a timeout or tell his team to foul, but you can't come out to the elbow.
Yeah, it wasn't bench decorum as much as it was coming out of the coach's box. Yeah. You're right. He was just trying to tell his team to get a foul.
Well, now Syracuse, the main challenge to get it in. They do have a timeout if they can't get it in, and they want to get it into the better free throw shooters. Cooney is the best at 88%. Fair is 71 and change. Christmas for a big guy, much improved this year, 72%. The one guy Syracuse really doesn't want to get it is Musakita.
Well, because Maryland had only five fouls, that's why hanging back was a little bit of a risk. You can come out, you can foul early on trying to get a steal, you're not losing anything.
They get it to Cooney. Boy, for a moment, it looked like Musakita was going to be Fair's only option on the inbound. They get it to Trevor Cooney, who's 88.2% for the season. Doesn't get there a lot, 45 out of 51. Hasn't been the line tonight.
Cooney makes both of these, which you would have to expect being as outstanding free throw shooter that he is. But Syracuse, under 5 seconds, they got 4 seconds in regulation. May want to foul on this inbounds and put Maryland on the line so you can avoid the three.
It's a background story right now, but Jim Boeheim was wondering last night, you know, what kind of a shake, what kind of a whistle he'd get tonight. Maryland has shot 27 free throws, Syracuse 4.
Well, Syracuse has taken nothing but jump shots.
Yes.
And it's a style of play issue.
Saying, if you're a conspiracy theorist, you have numbers to use.
Oliver Stone. Oliver Stone couldn't come up with a conspiracy that good.
Jim Boeheim discussing the options, what will happen. And again, you know, Cooney, as good as he is, you'd expect him to make both. And then it's the age-old debate. Do you foul with a three-point lead if you're Syracuse? We remember that Syracuse-Duke Classic at the Dome when they tried to foul and didn't, and Duke tied it in the final seconds on a three.
There's no question that if he makes these both, that they should foul.
Problem is C.J. Fair or Christmas can't commit the foul because they have four fouls apiece. And if you do wind up somehow in overtime, you need them. Huge free throws for Cooney.
Yeah, I'm not sure I'd worry about who fouls here. You try to avoid somebody with four getting it, but you're fouling so you don't have to worry about going.
Yes,
to overtime.
I agree. But ideally, you'd rather those really missed it. And Maryland a timeout.
Now that takes that totally out of play.
Let's quickly send you to Reese Davis.
All right, Sean, as soon as you guys are done, Fog Allen Fieldhouse, Buddy Hield, and the Sooners set to take on Kansas. Tip-off in less than 6 minutes as the Jayhawks try to wrap up a share of the Big 12 title.
Syracuse fans here agonizing. Sean Kerins there in the background. Terrific player of Syracuse talking to Barbara Boeheim, Jim's sister. So what do you do now if you're Maryland? You got to get the ball up the court. And you have 3.5 seconds to get perhaps a game-winning shot up if it's a three.
If you can catch the ball going toward the basket, you can get all the way to the rim in 3.5 seconds. Syracuse is going to want to make Maryland catch the ball going away from its basket, so that it's much more difficult. If you can get a long pass, that's great, but they'll try to run Seth Allen, Des Wells toward the ball and toward the basket. The ball will be underneath and not on the side. So you're going to want to run something to get the ball where it's going toward Maryland's basket.
Maryland's made 8 threes tonight, 6 of them by Seth Allen. He's had a great night shooting the 3, and he's the kind of guy who could push it up quickly and get his own 3. Mitchell looking to throw it deeper, settles for Allen. Ennis is there, Cooney comes to double. Allen, a heave at the buzzer, no good! And Syracuse survives and ends its 2-game losing streak and sets up a mammoth matchup Saturday in Charlottesville, Virginia, with first place on the line in the ACC as the Orange go to 13-2, right behind Virginia's 14-1. Maryland battled back in the second half from double digits down, but didn't come up with the win they really needed for their NCAA tournament hopes.
Really good job by both Tyler Ennis and Trevor Cooney, forcing Seth Allen to change direction and then corralling him at midcourt. That was a difficult shot, one that he could have made, but a difficult shot. Syracuse defended it well, made it tougher. Just that change in direction caused him to use more time, and he wasn't able to get up an even better one.
Well, given the situation, you said, Jay, how well it was defended, in 3.5 seconds to get that look from a guy who's made 6 threes tonight, Maryland had a good shot at pulling out the win.